Hi all, welcome to the Global Virtual Lecture Hall. So this is the inaugural lecture of the 2013 edition. And as you know, I'm very happy to see you and to welcome you in this experiment in global teaching. We have a kind of tight program today. So I will give you a short overview about the lecture, when Nathan will give us some outline of history, which is a long and glorious history so far. Then we will listen to Rolf record the video message. Rolf is currently actually flying from Shanghai to Zurich. And then we will have, starting 9:50, we will have a presentation of all the participating sites. After the coffee break at 10:40, we will have the first lecture, which is an introductory lecture on what we are really going to talk about in this series of lectures on embodied intelligence, which is actually our main goal. If for those of you who were involved in previous edition this year, we have maybe a bit more distributed the load and the honor to give lectures, and we have actually merged into the main thread, which is about our view of embodied cognition, and where we actually give a great importance to the fact that
Fabio, we don't hear you now.
Now
we hear you.
Okay, so of this view of embodied intelligence, but we will see it from different angles. And then we will have a goodbye. And so, which are the goals of the ShanghAI lectures? So maybe you already share them. And we have different objectives, because the first and maybe the most important one is to spread knowledge. So to spread knowledge on cutting edge topic. So this is an introductory course on AI, but it is a cutting edge. So the speakers, the lecturers, and the concept that we are spreading, Elvaug, without giving a lot of maths, and so trying to reduce to a minimum the prior knowledge required to attend these courses, are actually ideas at the frontier of both AI and robotics, or if you use or cognition and robotics, as we usually prefer to say. An important part of this effort is that we leverage on technology. So it would not be possible to be all together now without video conference technologies, and from this year we are also starting to stream the lectures in order to allow also remote participation. As you know, from the beginning we have recorded all the lectures which are available in the ShanghAI lecture repository, which I think at this point is a really important reference for this kind of topic about embodied intelligence. We are actually on the border between robotics cognition, neuroscience, and even we will have some talk on this synthetic biology and system biology, because this idea of morphological computation, which is has been pushed for a long time by Rolf, which is a kind of pioneer of this, is really a strong concept which can enlighten many different fields. And then I came to this. Another interesting point, which is a kind of side effect of this, is the fact that we are forced, next week we will announce what we have dubbed the koans, no? Some project, some challenge for the students, which but I don't want to anticipate much, but students will be grouped on a global level. So we are taking care to have mixed intercultural, let's say international groups. And this is not not a secondary aspect. We would like it to build a community, or if you want to build on the community which already exists, to tighten the links that we already have, and at the same point to have new members of this community. What do we expect from this serious lecture? Well, we expect, of course, and we are already doing it, more or less, to interaction among our universities, and through the mediation of the internet, streaming also with others, unknown people who are out there, and community building, I already told, and really, we would like, in a really open fashion, national, and not biased way, to contribute to develop a new view about intelligence. And since we believe to be intelligent beings, actually this is a way to spread light on our world and on our society. I mean, we know that the technology is now having, so it's actually shaping our world. We all know the impact that the ICT revolution and then the internet revolution have had on our society. We believe that the kind of paradigm shift that we are living and that as a researcher we are pushing, we really believe as a potential, a transformative potential of technology and as such on our society. So, as I told, we don't have a special prior knowledge, but this doesn't mean that we are not going to talk about deep concept and that we are not spreading ideas, but we are actually trying to focus on the idea. So if you are interested in the maths, you have a lot of references that you can follow. And then this is you can on the website you can find the syllabus of a lecture, and it's clear explicit what I was saying. No? So we go from this today's overview. Next time, mainly Rolf will give us some deep, some subtle and deep ideas on the embodied intelligence, and then we will go through. So there are some related areas, like for instance soft robotics and bio-inspired robotics and technology. I already quoted the synthetic biology and system biology, so the natural and artificial biology. And so it will be fun and interesting, and I really hope that we will be able to carry home some new idea. I really also I have some expectations on the projects and the students, and what the students will be able to carry out from the project. So we, as usual, we use as a lecture reference the Rolf's and Josh's book, Our Body Shapes the Way We Think, which has many, several translations, at least as in Arabic, Chinese, and French so far, and Japanese so far, right? Alphabetic order, rigorous alphabetic order. So the typical lecture will actually be, so today is a bit different. Usually we will have an introductory part in the first hour and a couple of lectures, but we will adapt it several according to the necessity. So really welcome, and I now pass the stage to I want to thank all the sites which are involved in this experiment, the many technicians in many universities which are involved, from Carlos Tercero to Santana, Humboldt University Berlin, ShanghAI Yao Tong, which actually gives the name, and actually the ShanghAI lecture started in Shanghai a few years ago. The sponsors and Nathan, Martin, Avinash, and Mark Susser, just to quote the persons which had more, which more contributed to the practical implementation of this experiment. And now I pass the floor to Nathan, which will give us a piece of history and on the ShanghAI. Nathan, you may know him, is a researcher at the AI lab in Zurich, and actually has been extremely functional to the development of a ShanghAI lecture concept that we are now continue. And I think we are not exaggerating saying that it is a real expert on distant learning and on the kind of things we are doing today. So Nathan, the floor is yours, and welcome, and thank you for being here.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Fabio, for the introduction. If I look at this slide, which I'm going to change in a second, you say that I'm the brain of this series. After you watch the whole lecture series, you might not think that being the brain is the best part, but for the moment I take it as a compliment, so thank you. So I'm a PhD candidate at the LAB in Zurich.
I agree with you.
With Rolf Pfeiffer, and I've been working on the ShanghAI lectures for the last 5 years or so. In 2009 we started, when Thierry Bücheler, a colleague of mine, was managing the whole project with the goals that Fabio already mentioned. In 2010, I took over the project management and we included some new sites. In 2011-12, we're continuing the series here from Zurich, and now I'm very happy that Madrid is taking over. You see, this map shows in small red dots the sites that have been working or participating in the ShanghAI lectures since 2009. You may not see it so well, so I added the names and then it becomes really a mess, but it's quite exciting to have over 50 universities who worked in the ShanghAI lectures since 2009. And it's great to see so many of our old friends again this year, and also nice that we have some new participants. Welcome to all of you, wherever you are, whatever time zone you're in. Special thanks to Fabio, Bonsignorio, Martin, Silvia, Avinash from Madrid, from Spain, for taking over this project and continuing pushing the limits and the boundaries of the ShanghAI lectures. If you look at these names, do you see any pattern here? Look closer. There's a lot of AI here. Everyone has to do with AI. Isn't that amazing? So I think this is very auspicious. So what team. I'm sure the ShanghAI Lectures will continue to be a success. And I'm really thankful for all these AI people to carry on the lectures. Quickly, I want to show to you what I'm doing here. That's my office at the moment. So you see it's a little bit of a mess. I'm taking control of the video conference with help from SWITCH, the Swiss University Education and Research Network. So we take care of the video conference. We do the slide sharing, we play videos, and we record everything. So big thanks to the guys at SWITCH for making this possible. And you see at the bottom the cake. Every Thursday morning here in Zurich at the A-Lab, there's cake from our secretary. So while you are continuing with the lectures, I'm enjoying my cake and listening to you. And with that, I give back to Fabio. And again, thanks to all of you for participating, and I wish you a very exciting and great lecture series. Thank you very much.
So maybe now you may play the welcome from Ralph.
Okay, hold on a second.
Welcome to the ShanghAI Lectures. Welcome to the Global Virtual Lecture Hall. I'm currently traveling and won't be able to participate in this opening lecture online. So this is a recording from my hotel room in Shanghai, where the ShanghAI Lectures originally started in 2009. Since then, we have been organizing this lecture series together with Shanghai Jiaodong University at the University of Zurich. And now I'm very happy that my friend and colleague Fabio Bonsignorio of the University Carlos III in Madrid has taken over the organization. And I'm also very happy to see that many, many people have agreed to participate in the lecture series and contribute their own ideas to this global virtual lecture hall. I can see that the recording is a bit dark, but in the background you can see a bit of Shanghai as I see it from my hotel room. I will be participating in the lecture series with a number of contributions, and I'm very much looking forward to it. I would like to thank everyone for participating, and I would like to thank in particular Fabio Bonsignorio, but also Renata Labhard, who put everything together again. And I'm very much looking forward to this great global event. So enjoy, and thank you for your interest and participation.
So, now it's the time for the site's presentation. So maybe, Nathan, you may call one by one the participating sites which are connected.
Okay, so let's start alphabetically on the list on the ShanghAI Lectures site. I think Budapest hasn't connected now, so and let's see if Chiba is here. I think they had some technical issues and could not connect. Then we have Humboldt University in Berlin. So I'll switch the screen to Berlin and would invite Verena to share her presentation in a second.
On the live stream. Can you see the slides and hear me?
Yes, we can see the slides and we can hear you.
Okay, perfect. Then hello Fabio, hello Nathan, hello everybody today. I'm very excited that Humboldt University Berlin is again part of the ShanghAI Lectures. We've been participating since 2010, so this is our fourth participation in the ShanghAI Lectures. And here in Berlin at Humboldt University, it's an official class on embodied artificial intelligence. And so we're in Berlin. And as you can see here, some of the famous things about Berlin. So Berlin is not only famous for its heavy history, its currywurst and other things, but we also have a very vivid scientific community with several big universities here, where Humboldt University is one of them. And our research group, so I'm heading the cognitive robotics group here at the computer science department, and our research group does research on interaction and see how when we can interact with the environment and with others.
The audio seems to break up from time to time. I'm not sure if it's only here, but maybe you can change something to the microphone.
Is it better now? So I try this one. So we focus on interaction not only with the environment, but also with others. And we want to see how we can get from simple sensory motor to social interaction. And some of the experiments here involve some experiments with humanoid robots, where we work on motor babbling. Mm-hmm. We want to see how motor maps are created and adapted to the body and to the circumstances. And we want to investigate how tool use can be developed and how this leads to intelligence behavior in summary. Here are some of our... On the next slide, you can see some of the robots we're using. So we're using humanoid robots, mostly NAOs. We use wheeled robots. We use Lego NXTs for our exercises sometimes. And we also have a whole fleet of flying autonomous robots. Within the ShanghAI Lectures, we're also hosting one of the lectures on November 7th and giving a lecture on creating body maps and also on the importance of the body for the development of intelligence and how much of this is innate and how much is evolved and developed over time. I also want to mention a special master track we have here in Berlin. It's a master track on the science of intelligence, and it's a cooperation between the Technical University, Humboldt Universität, and the Free University in Berlin, between departments of computer science and departments of psychology. And so if you're in Berlin, you'll have the opportunity to attend many different classes that are related to intelligence. So thank you very much for listening. You can find more information on our webpage. And I also want to thank our local organizers here, Damien Briggs and Andreas Geronzi. And here on the slide, you can see the building we're currently at. This is our main library of Humboldt University, the Film Center. So thank you very much, and I give back to the others.
Thank you very much, Verena. Next on the list, I think, is Wooch. So let me see whether there is audio connection with Vooch. I think I had some small issues before. Let's try. Hello, Vooch.
Hello, welcome from Vooch. We'll try to take access in Shanghai Artificial Intelligence lectures. Okay, that's all in this moment. I will take it with Krzysztof Pomorski, proof, and also we have an additional university. It will be University of Lodz, because we are technical. We are Lodz University of Technology, and also in this lecture with University of Lodz. Okay, thank you.
Thank you to Vooch. Thanks for participating. So next on the list, I think, is Xi'an. So I'll switch to Northwestern Polytechnic University in Xi'an, China. Let's see who's there. I think we can't hear you now, Xi'an. The sound is a bit low. I'll try to increase the sound.
Hello, Nathan. Hello, Nathan. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. Good morning, good evening, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dustin Li. I'm from Northwestern Polytechnic University, Xi'an City of China. As we know, Xi'an is one of the civilization origins of world civilization, and there are many important sites and relics in this city. This is our beautiful campus. We have two different campus, Chang'an campus at the bottom picture, and the Youyi campus on the top of the picture.
Dustin, so I think we can't see the slides. Can you maybe check the screen sharing?
Oh, wait a moment. Sorry.
Now I think you should see the slides in a few seconds now. Yeah, Dustin, you can see your screen, and now you can start the slideshow, and then you can see your slides.
I can see my slides.
PowerPoint, right. Dustin, you can just open the PowerPoint and show it, then we can see it.
Okay.
Yes, now you can see the slides.
Okay. As we know, our university, NTU, was founded in 1938, We have two campuses. The Chang'an campus is a new one and a big one. We have many different. Can you see? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can see the slides and we can hear you.
Okay. And this is about our lab, multi-agent robot system lab in School of Computer Science and Technology. In our group, the main study here includes multi-agent robot system, just like robot soccer system, machine learning, computational intelligence, autonomous development robotics, real-time artificial intelligence, also embodied intelligence. For this year, we have the students from three departments, and participated the ShanghAI Lectures for five years. It's exciting time for all of us. As Rolf said, it is the fifth year for all of us. We hope our global lecture will bring us more inspirations and more encouragement for all of us. So thank you all.
Okay. Thank you, Dustin. Thank you to Sian. And I think next in the list is University of Osaka. So I'm switching to Osaka now.
Hi, can you hear me all?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, great. I'm sorry I didn't prepare any slides because I thought the professor would be there, but I would be happy to give an introduction on Osaka University. So first of all, thank you for again inviting us to the ShanghAI Lecture. It's always a really nice experience and we're happy to be here and to learn a lot about new technology and intelligence. So Osaka University is a really old university because it has been created in 1931. There is nowadays three big campuses: the campus for linguistic learning, one for law and economy, and here we are in the more engineering and medicine campus. So especially we are in the graduate school of engineering, so this graduate school aims to develop the creative researcher and advanced engineer with specialized knowledge on very high level. So this school started in 1953 under the new university system. I will not get into the detail because it's not the point, but this graduate school had a lot of degree, including mechanical engineering, chemistry, electronics, robotics, and many more. And so I think this lecture is really into the mind of our graduate school, and one more time, we are happy to be here. And that's it. Thank you very much.
Hey, thank you very much for participating. Next in the list, I think, is Moscow. So I'm switching to Moscow now. And also give you presenter rights, and I'm ready to play the video. It'll just take like 10 seconds to switch for playing the video whenever you tell me.
Right, while we are waiting. Shall
I play the video now?
Yes. Can you hear me?
Okay.
Can you hear me, Nathan?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yes, can I start? Or will you start with the video? Well, I can start.
Maybe I'll play the video first and then you can say something.
Right, okay.
Yes, please go ahead.
Yes, hello, Nathan, hello, Fadi, hello, Ron, hello, everybody in the Global Lecture Hall. It's my pleasure and privilege to introduce our university to the other participants. So, as you know, we were founded in 1991, but we date back to 1930. That's where the Institute of History and Archives was founded. So, there are 13 institutions. There are 26 research education centers, 18 international research education centers, and about 12,600 students at our university. You can see one of the museums here because we are hosting part of the collection of Fine Arts Christians Museum here, and it's education through art, that's the main motto of our university. So we offer training at BA, MA, and doctoral levels in various fields of the humanities, including history, philology, philosophy, psychology, linguistics, anthropology, Eastern culture, sociology, intelligent systems, artificial intelligence department, and others. So for the first time, we participated in ShanghAI Lectures in 2010, and now it's the fourth year, and this year, the students from artificial intelligence, economics, management, law, psychology, linguistics, philosophy, Institute of Ghana, and Russian Academy of Science have signed for the program. And what are our main research interests? I'm the director of the Center for Cognitive Programs and Technologies, and at this center we are doing research in cognitive linguistics, cognitive psychology, cognitive philosophy, and artificial intelligence. We cooperate with the French Association of Cognitive Science, we cooperate with Munich University, and we are also members of the distributed cognition, distributed language group, headed by Stephen Covey from Hartford University, UK. We are learning, we're trying to learn not only this sensory motor experience, but also social interaction, just like Humboldt University, which is our partner. And it's a pleasure to see our partners, Humboldt and Madrid III University and some others among our participants. Artificial intelligence at our university is mainly concentrating on machine learning, GSM method of data analysis, which was introduced by Professor Victor Finn, is applied in various fields such as evidence-based medicine, cognitive sociology, cognitive forensic science, attribution of historical documents, hermeneutics, computational linguistics, ontologies, and robotics. And now I'm giving the floor to Tatiana Volkova, who is one of the local co-organizers of ShanghAI Lectures, together with Maria Katowska. And Tatiana will take the floor.
Yeah, thank you. We have established a new robotics center recently. It's quite small, but we already have a park of robots, as I would say. So we have now, we have one Ovi robot and six POP bots for the students to make experiments on applying artificial intelligence methods in robotics field. And this lab is based on artificial intelligence department, which students are, most of the students in fact here in ShanghAI Lectures. And I'm very happy that we participate because we don't, our students don't receive any introduction into cognitive science, into cognitive AI. So I'm very happy to be in this, and I was a student myself. I should say that improved many skills for me. Thank you.
Right, and then to finish to say that we are continuing to push ShanghAI Lectures, and last year we had the pleasure and privilege of providing guest lecture. I was giving a guest lecture. It's a very special experience. It was in cognitive modeling, and I must tell that we're looking forward to this year. And I would like to use the three overused words which are forbidden now on many TV and many radios, but I'd like to use them. ShanghAI Lectures are amazing, incredible, awesome. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Vera Sobotkina, and your team in Moscow. It's great to have you aboard. So, to save some time, I just go to the next participant, which is ShanghAI Jiaotong University. Let's see, there's He Sheng Wang. He Sheng, do you want to play the video first, or to say a few words first?
Maybe I say a few words first.
Okay, please go ahead.
How nice, can you see the slides?
Not yet. Can you start sharing? Yes, we can see the slides now.
Okay, so hello Fabio, hello Nathan and everyone. I'm He Sheng Wang from ShanghAI Jiaotong University. I will give a very brief introduction about our university. We are located in Shanghai, the middle east of China. And we are the hoster of the first ShanghAI lecture in 2009, and we are very great that we have been with ShanghAI Lecture for 5 years. And you can see some picture of the ShanghAI and the history of our university. We are estimated in the year 1896 and one of the oldest university in China. And also according to some ranking system, we are top 5 university in China. And here is the view of our campus. So we have totally 24 schools with more than 2,000 faculty members and 38,000 students. And come to our school, we are School of Electric Information and Electrical Engineering. We have totally 5 departments and more than 300 faculty members and 5,000 students. So our department is was established in the year 1958, and we have totally 64 faculty members and 400 undergraduate students and more than 400 postgraduate students. So in our department, we did a lot of work about continuous engineering, pattern recognition, and so on. We are come from the autonomous robot laboratory. Where research interesting is about service robot. So we did some program development and also some hardware development. So you can see some image of our robot. Also, one of the major research interests is assistive robot for the elderly and disabled people. We developed some wheelchair and some intelligent wheelchair and the intelligent arm. So you may see some of the robot in the movie, in the movie. So also we did a lot of cooperation project with the industry. We have some cooperation project with many industry factories such as ABB, Yaskawa. And so without further introduction, I would like Nathan to play the movie by our university. So this movie is performed by a very beautiful girl in our university and some of our robots. You can see in this movie. So Nathan, could you play this movie? So now that I think you can stop here, and thank you all.
Okay. Okay, thank you very much. So I will pass the floor back to Fabio. And well, that was the round of introduction. Thank you all for participating. So now, Fabio, it's your turn again.
Yeah, we actually scheduled after the site presentation, we scheduled the introductory lectures. Maybe I can just, since we didn't present our our university, I didn't prepare any slide because another, like in Osaka, another person was supposed to do, and But I want to say that this idea of a ShanghAI Lectures is extremely in sync with the original mission of our university, because our university was founded some 20 years ago, so it's a very young university. It's a middle-sized one, and it is in South Madrid. South Madrid was in the past the industrial the industrial suburb. Leganés was an industrial suburb of Madrid, and the idea of the founders of university, in particular the late Gregorio Pérez Baba, which was one of the authors of the democratic modern constitution of Spain, was really to bring high-level knowledge to the lower classes of a society, and to really revitalize the industrial tissue of Spain, of the Madrid area, by pushing technology and humanities too. I really think that this project of the ShanghAI Lecture is really in sync with the mission of our university. Then, looking at the program, I saw that we fixed a break around 10:30, so we are slightly in advance. I think we can start again at 10:35. I have nothing more to say for now. Hi, so I am again. So now what the purpose of this second part of the lecture is to introduce the topics that we are going to discuss during the lecture series of this year. As I anticipate, we will see it mainly from our embodied intelligence standpoint, but from different angles. And I also think that at least a few of the speakers will give an angle which is potentially significantly different from our angle. Why? Because actually we have, as you used to say, we have many questions, and we have some idea about the answer, but for sure there is a lot of work to be done yet. Why? Because actually our purpose is not ambitious at all. No? We want to define concretely and scientifically what natural and artificial intelligence are. It's really a challenging topic. And I would say that so far there are many, many good ideas around. I think that our view on embodied cognition is probably, we believe, is probably the way to go. But there are many problems, unsolved problems, and many challenges to be coped. So there are many reasons to do that. Intelligent systems and increasingly intelligent machines are becoming an important part of our experience. So they are also becoming part of media reports, and so it's quite easy to be misled by media reports on intelligent systems or the impact that they could have or not have on our society. I mean, people like me may think that they are kind of panacea, so that the technology will save the planet, and in particular robotics and AI will save the planet. But there might be also dark sides of a problem that need to be investigated. But first of all, you need to understand what we're talking about. And the minimum objective of this lecture, what you should carry home, is to have some idea about how to on the issues related to natural and artificial intelligence. And then we are actually pushing a different way from the traditional approach to both in the AI and robotics, as we actually emphasize the fact that the body and the mind are actually like two sides of the same coin. So we believe, I mean, this idea has been around for some time now, and in particular Rolf has pushed them for several years, for many years, I would say. But still, I think there is they need to be spread, and also they have a significant impact on how we perceive ourselves, and so have a clear impact on what we see as the future of our society, you know, which is challenged under many respects, from global warming to the peak oil, you can believe or not, for sure overpopulation. So we have a problem on resources, we have a problem of the environment, so we have many problems. And many people think that technology, and in particular intelligent machines, robots, call them, could be part of a solution. So why it's informal consent of the media? So we are. This is just one of the examples of system which were in the media. So I mean, actually, where we'll be in a few months, where this same David Levy is organizing a conference in the UK about sex with robots. And another example which could have, for instance, for other people, but not only for other people, also for people carrying heavy loads, or the robotic suits, or a project which is already well developed in Korea is the robotics English teacher. So you know that in Korea, they still have a shortage of English language teachers, and actually robots, at least for childs, could be, and they think they are a possible solution. And then they have one possible dream for drinking beer, which is the beer serving robot. So they are probably already many untapped opportunities. So there are probably intelligent machines that could be developed. I believe that if you really want to understand what can be done, what cannot be done, what could be done in 10 years, and which kind of research we need to do to go there, we need to have a kind of understanding of what we mean as intelligence. Another recent example is the humanoid robot Baxter. So it's humanoid to a certain extent, but it has two arms, it has a kind of facial expression, and actually is a system that is somehow disrupting the traditional idea of industrial manufacturing. So, because so far, the shop floor, the industrial robots were welding arms and very simple, not simple, but conceptually simple machines doing with what we today would call a limited intelligence. And so if you look at this kind of system, which essentially, and at an early stage probably, implements some intelligence into the system, into robotic system, more than it has been done so far in the industrial area. You have a number of benefits, like not having to program too much, being able to learn by demonstration, having a higher level, comparatively much significantly higher level of flexibility and versatility. and being affordable. I mean, these machines cost about 18,000 euros, dollars or euros, you know, but euros, the technological exchange rate between euro and dollar is 1-to-1. And that's kind of common sense. So this actually has an impact on the possibility to reinsource manufacturing into Europe. Why this kind of understanding, what we call the informed understanding of the media, is relevant? Because actually it's actually triggering already a debate, because this book, which was from two renowned scholars in social science, was actually saying that this dramatic increase in productivity made possible by intelligent machine is actually changing the condition of the workforce, meaning that the robots why race against the machine, because the robots in many tasks can be a cheaper and more affordable solution than a person. So this is, for instance, in the US, where we are witnessing on one side a really movement to reinsource a lot of manufacturing that in the past was outsourced. Actually, this reinsourcing is made possible by a very high and unprecedented level of automation. So people is a bit worried, because some people are worried because, like, wait, okay, so what's going on? So, and I really advise, because to check this TED talk by Eric Brynjolfsson, because actually has a more mature view. So I mean, in general, we should not see the possibility to make more things with less effort as a menace. No? So at first glance, it is a positive thing. So we have to engineer things, and maybe we really need to remap the kind of jobs that can be done by a person and not by a robot, and the kind of jobs that a robot can do. So the person should not lose time to try to learn how to perform something that a robot will do better. This is the concept, it's in two words, the concept that is analyzed in this talk on race with the machine. So the machine actually help. And so now let's, as I anticipated already, I told you in the beginning that this is meant as an introductory presentation. So I will really, while in general we have probably more questions than answers, in particular today we will raise more questions than answer. So we, as usual, we use as an official textbook of a lectures the book from Rolf, How the Body Shapes the Way We Think. Well, really, this idea that we are trying to develop are really well elaborated. And it is, so as I already anticipated, there is a Chinese edition, a Japanese edition, there is an Arabic edition, which is shorter. I don't know why. I don't know if Arabic is more concise or if they did the summer. There is a French edition. And then there are some additional, for instance, there is an e-book, which actually is a kind of summary of this idea, which can be downloaded from the from the link, yeah. And then there is an AVIA, if it is printed in paper, a book which is very, which maybe gives more details, which can also be useful, which is Understanding Intelligence, which is a few years before the other one. And now I really like to quote this, because this was an handbook that was commissioned by the U.S. Army in 1850, around 1850, because was the age of the exploration of the Far West. And what happened around in the 40s of the 19th century was in the U.S. was that actually many expeditions to the West were lost, because they followed the wrong paths, so they finished into mountains, so they didn't know. And so this Captain Marcy prepared this handbook. And what I really like in this handbook is a warning to the people wanting to organize an expedition to the Far West. But for some reason, I think it's something very close to what we are doing. And the warning is that, well, consider this, that the different agents which are managing the different routes, the shipping companies, the train, the railway companies, all these people have interest. They already have invested a lot into some specific route, which might not be the right one for you. And so the caveat here is, this is our biased vision. All visions are biased, and so you should always keep your critical sense alive. Apart from that, from my bias, I really think that we are right. And so let's enter a bit into the idea. So as I told you, we have an ambitious purpose. Now, the ambitious purpose is to try to capture what is meant as intelligence. No? So you may have your received idea, and if you think about it, it's extremely difficult to clarify. No? So you know that it's a common experience to lose against a chess player. In which sense and to which extent this chess player could be considered intelligent? Because at a certain point, you may think it is not, right? So you don't have a feeling that a chess playing machine is really intelligent. For instance, it cannot do coffee, or it cannot solve equations. So it can just do that task. And in fact, this idea is extremely controversial. For instance, some definition taken from last century's psychology journal, but probably today the situation could be even worse. Now, several have been of this intelligence definition have been proposed, and so you can have several, right? So I'm now reading what I see. The ability to carry on abstract thinking. So for instance, and so chess is okay, math is okay, grabbing a cup is not okay under this. And it's a common no fact in robotics that it's okay, but the problem of a chess player winning against average human is really almost trivial, because it can run on your PC. And a chess player winning against the world champion is less trivial, but it can be solved. This stupid problem of catching unknown or grasping unknown is not. So so this definition, for instance, could be challenging from some practical point, from a point of view of the kind of intelligence that we exhibit every day in our daily task. Maybe something that we another definition from Colvin, having learned or ability to learn to adjust oneself to the environment. Or another which is close to what it's typical of a jargon of a new commission, which is the ability to adapt oneself adequately to relatively new situation in life, which resembles a lot a typical buzz phrase, which is ability to adapt to open-end environment. It's typical jargon. Or other that when we go down, maybe we still, but no, the capacity to acquire capacity might be one of my favorite. No? So it's not a specific capability that you have, but it's the possibility to learn to do different things, to learn a language or to speak, but also to write or to grab coffee or to work or things like that. So this is seems more, and it seems also more typical of what we see in the real world. Then, just to make a long story short, there is this nice website, now not more update, not anymore updated, which actually listed 70 different definitions of intelligence. And I think that you may generate others. I personally challenge this quote from Sternberg, which says that there are seen to be almost as many definitions. Okay, almost. No? So probably there are more definitions than the expert. So any expert is probably swinging among different definitions that he likes. No? A nice definition is actually proposed by Legger and Atter in a nice text, which is a collection of definition of intelligence. And actually they abstract with three main, characteristics. The property that an agent has to interact with the environment or a series of environment, the agent's ability to succeed to some goal objectives, or in summary, but I think and you may probably agree, has still some limitation, is intelligence measure an agent's ability to achieve goals in a wide range of environment. Why? Because we have conceptual problems at every level. For instance, think to the problem of playing chess, right? So, you can have different ideas. So you may have no particular interest or experience for chess. Then you may have you know that there are this baby genius very good at chess at 5 years when they are five, and but again we can it's a typical characteristic of intelligence, the fact that what you really mean with playing, right? So actually this dog is playing with chess. I can also play in chess by like darts. So actually, a typical characteristic of intelligence is this possibility to see, to look at something that the chess, the current generation, chess playing machine won't do. So seeing the chess something different, in a different way. For instance, this dog is showing much more intelligence than the chess machine, right? Because it's inventing a new usage of the pieces. So, so it's really challenging. So we may put this in different ways. So because one way to see this is which are the necessary and sufficient conditions for a system to be intelligent? Or, and then, are robots and humans intelligent, and in which sense? Maybe a more productive approach is if I have a behavior to which I am interested, no? Because I was actually putting a bad line in a bad light a chess playing machine. But I mean, if what I am interested to is the behavior that interests me is the ability to win a chess play, intending as chess play the real chess game. And not throwing dice with different pieces, which is an interesting and legal usage of chess. So a more productive question is probably, given behavior, how does it come about? How does it emerge? Now, just to show this idea of a subjectivity, no? Because we tend to, what we will see, no? we tend to attribute also intelligence to what we see. And it's not extremely easy to see if, to characterize what is really intelligent and what looks subjectively intelligent. So, and now I think Nathan can show a couple of movies which may add, we may be a good point for this, for continuing.
Okay, 1 second while I switch the video.
この研究所の石黒博さんたちがキャッツも大きなテーマです。人と友達になれるロボットを目指して開発されたロボビー。この研究所の石黒博さんたちが研究を進めているものです。ロボビーは言葉を交わしたり体に触れ合うことで人とコミュニケーションが取れるように設計されています。腕や腹など16箇所にある銀色のシートは感圧センサーです。人の皮膚に当たり触ると敏感に反応します。相手からの働きかけに対し800通りの行動パターンを自分で判断して返します。センサーを撫でられたり優しい言葉をかけられると人に甘える仕草も見せます。しかし実社会に出してみるとまだ課題が山積みであることが分かってきました。小学校でロボビーに英語を話させ海外からの転校生として子どもたちと友達になれるか観察しました。あちこちのセンサーを触られ複数の子どもから話しかけられたロボビーは誰と話していいか分からず混乱してしまったのです。
Kaplan says you can keep talking while the video is playing.
Okay, so I have a question that I hope someone will try to answer in the virtual hall. So we have seen two examples which are significant examples of robotics of robotics application. So and the question is, are these systems intelligent? So in your opinion, do you see this system as intelligent? So I don't know if someone wanted to try to ask.
If anyone wants to reply, just open your microphone and tell me which site you are, and I can put you on the big screen.
Okay, so it seems that nobody wanted to try. I think that a reason could be that you feel puzzled, right? Because, well, on one side, if you think, for instance, of this gazing, right? Of this activity of following a ball or things, or also to have this kind of interaction. I mean, if you may be tempted to say yes, it is intelligent, and then you know actually you have seen a video, well, you know that maybe changing the condition, the boundary condition, the system, we didn't see it in this video, but so you may be so it is actually subjective. So probably the answer to is it intelligent is yes and no. So yes, because some of the things, for instance, this gazing activity of being able to exchange a few words are actually part of what we are used to consider as intelligent. But I think it might be it's also maybe also this subjective, but you feel unease to say this is an intelligent behavior, and this is what you actually the kind of idea that you have in most cases. The interesting point is that we also don't have a clear way to say it is stupid, right? So because we need to conceptualize it. And it's interesting that so modernly we tend to say that there are things that we cannot benchmark, that we should organize a challenge, or we should organize a competition or something like that. And actually the very first example of one of these challenges was the Turing test. So the Turing test is extremely wise in what? In the fact that since I don't know how to model intelligence, I don't have a clear idea about what an intelligent behavior is. I really cut off every kind of analytical examination, and I do a simple test where I use a human as a judge, and then the test is that I need to be the machine. In this case, and the human interact by a keyboard, for instance, with a human, and the intelligent system is the system which is able to fool the interrogator. So, if an interrogator, in this case, actually we are considering a man or a woman. But if an interrogator is not able to distinguish between the man and or the woman, the person, the human, the other human, supposed to be intelligent, and the machine, this means that the machine is intelligent. So This seems a kind of a Columbus egg, no? Because you say, okay, I really don't know, but I trust the fact that when I will meet an intelligent machine, I will recognize it, no? As much like as we do with people, no? So why you think that I am an intelligent conscious being like you? Because you are used to interact with a system like me, and to think that I am like you, right? So where we are fooled by the intentional attribution is that since we are programmed in this way, programmed maybe is not, so since we are made in this way, our process are behaving this way, we tend to attribute intelligent behaviors to everything, right? To every moving thing, you know? So we tend to talk to the computer, huh? Well, damn the machine, why you are giving this bug? No, and this is kind of, so this so seems a very, so it's the idea, Turing's idea is let's do an empirical test and let's see what happened. And this idea was actually challenged by the Chinese room Voigt experiment by Searles, because Searles used the observe, yes, but what about, let's think that I have a catalog of all possible input and a set of rules allowing to map the possible text input to the supposed correct, to the human answer to that text input. I don't need any real knowledge. And the example is, let's think that Searle, this actually, this could be the Italian room Voigt experiment for Chinese, right? Or Russian, or no? So it's Chinese, but if you don't speak any Chinese and you don't read any Chinese, so the idea is Searle is into the room and has this lookup tables, no? Written lookup tables where he know what ideograms he has to, kanji ideogram he has to associate to other kanji ideograms. So he can answer properly without having any real understanding of Chinese. So and the point from Searle is, so what really tests the Turing test? And you may object to this because an observation could be, but how long is the table? Is it finite? How much time it will require to read up into the table? So it's not so, it's as a Voigt experiment, could also be criticized from a computational standpoint. So it's not clear, for instance, not clear to me if a finite table of input and a finite table of rules for processing the inputs and giving the output Chinese characters would be enough. I think this is enough, but the idea is clear. So the idea is that, well, but how you can really trust that the system inside is really intelligent? So, and yeah, I hope to have more success with that I had with a previous question is, so you may try to think about pros and cons of a serial experiment in the Turing test, and we may have a short student presentation, maybe kind of this discussion next time. But I think that this is already touching the main point. So the main point is that it's not, even if we want to have an empirical criteria, we still are in trouble. But think about it, and you will probably rediscover some of the serious issue which are affecting this problem, this idea. Then, so there is a prize for this, the Loebner Prize competition, which is supposed to be given to the first system being able to pass the Turing test. And then there have been some, you may have heard of Eliza, which was a kind of simulated doctor interacting by text. And there is a very nice Turing test for replicants in Blade Runner. I don't know if Nathan has the video. You have? Okay, maybe we can show, we can have a look at it.
Do you want to see both videos or just the first one and then you comment on it?
I would say the Blade Runner one, since.
Okay, 1 second.
Oh, or both. Both use of chaos. No, both. Both.
Next subject, Kowalski Leon. Engineer waste disposal. File section, new employee, 6 days.
Come in.
Sit down. Care if I talk?
I'm kind of nervous when I take tests.
Just please don't move.
Oh, sorry. I already had an IQ test this year. I don't think I've ever had one.
The action time is a factor in this, so please pay attention. Now answer as quickly as you can.
Sure.
1187 is Winterbosser.
That's the hotel.
What?
Where I live.
Nice place?
Yeah, sure, I guess. Is that part of the test?
No. Just warming up, that's all.
It's not fancy or anything.
You're in a desert, walking along in the sand when all of a sudden...
Is this the test now?
Yes. You're in a desert, walking along in the sand when all of a sudden you look...
What one?
What?
A desert.
Doesn't make any difference what desert is completely hypothetical.
But how come I'd be there?
Maybe you're fed up. Maybe you want to be by yourself. Who knows? You look down and you see a tortoise, Leon. It's crawling towards you.
Tortoise? What's that?
You know what a turtle is?
Of course.
Same thing.
I've never seen a turtle. But I understand what you mean.
You reach down, you flip the tortoise over on its back, Leon.
You make up these questions, Mr. Holden? They write them down for you.
The tortoise lays on its back, its belly baking in the hot sun, beating its legs, trying to turn itself over, but it can't. Not without your help. But you're not helping.
What do you mean I'm not helping?
I mean you're not helping. Why is that, Leon? They're just questions, Leon. In answer to your query, they're written down for me. It's a test designed to provoke an emotional response. Shall we continue? Describe in single words only the good things that come into your mind. About your mother?
Your mother?
Yeah.
Let me tell you about my mother.
We see that this was not exactly a Turing test, right? But what we can see that in the future, performing tests of intelligent machine could become dangerous, right? This is interesting. So this is fictional, but the idea was to identify a long set of questions which would discriminate, so a bit more sophisticated what we try to do, between a human natural intelligence and a replicant artificial intelligence. And now we have something that I think is more similar to a Turing test, which is the Haibo movie. So what is really interesting here is that, look, so this dog seems to think that Haibo is passed the dog level Turing test, no? Yeah, and another insight is this, that Of course, what we mean as intelligence, we mean human-like intelligence, we mean dog-like intelligence. So a dog-like intelligence should be testing in a situation like this. By the way, as I told before, so it seems that this dog thinks that Aibo is a dog. But it should probably interact in a more wider test. So, and here we come to something that you may have met in your experience. Now, I met it in a work interview many years ago. And in those time, I knew how to answer to this. Now I don't. But the idea is that should you measure intelligence by these kind of things? So I give you a series of geometrical figures, and you have to fill it. So is this what we should mean as intelligence? So let's say after all the 50 years of AI, maybe the thing that we have understood is that it's a bit limitative, no? Because this is something for which a computer could be programmed to. So it's not so different from chess playing, and maybe it's even easier, right? So, and actually this haiku issue reads quite easily to a number of issues. So does it depend on genes? Does it depend on training? I think it depends a lot on training, because you may know that people in the hard science have on an average a higher IQ at the end of a curriculum than the general population, because they pass all their times playing with geometry and logic, probably, right? So maybe they are training. There is another nice aspect, which is the Flynn effect. Actually, it seems that IQ increase over years. But why? Because you get used to do this kind of test if you perform this test for some time. For instance, it is a common experience that you feel that the problems which were getting you crazy when you were an undergraduate, you feel they can be explained in 2 minutes, right? I mean, this kind of but is this the kind of abilities? So many people have challenged this idea, no? Because and actually, starting from Turing, if you think how the text, the Turing test is thinking, is thought. Because actually, at least we should measure many, many different numbers and many different abilities. And on this, we have several. So, Sternmer, we reported before, or Jay Gould. So, actually, it's very difficult to think that a single number, so intelligence, because why we quote I could test, because say, hey, you are talking about intelligence, but there is a popular way to measure intelligence. This means that it's not that a big deal. So the problem is that it has the same limitation of a chess player. So the fact that we are very good at performing IQ test doesn't mean that you are really intelligent. Now, for instance, are you able to build an igloo if you are not an Eskimo? Probably not. So, or how to build a camp tent. So, I mean, there are many things where I would say, and this is the reason why at some point we will talk about synthetic life and natural life and system biology, is that we are led to believe that what is really missing in these systems, including the previous robots, like also the iCub, are is kind of life, no? Which capability to create new solutions. So it's the creativity which is missing, but creativity in terms of behavior. So inventing a behavior for an unknown situation. So an example is also brain computer interface. So how you learn to use some specific potential in your on the surface or your brain to drive a mechanical arm. So this can only be explained with the possibility of a brain to really invent completely new behavior repertories that are not in nature, no? Because nobody before the invention of a EEG was in the condition of moving something by sampling a number of points on his own brain. No? So this gives an idea of what we see in natural intelligence and we don't really capture so far. So I think this is quite clear. Now, what we really expect from artificial intelligence, cognition science call you, or even robots call it, if you use your favorite branding for the concept. So actually, we would like to be able to understand the building principle of biological system. We would like to really capture what is missing, for instance, because also the Turing test is assuming that we don't, even if you don't believe in Searle's objections, no, in the Chinese room, to the Chinese room objection, still have some, so have a big flow, so they don't tell anything about how we should build the machine. Now, Turing test, if it works, it will work when we will have an intelligent machine, but I want to build an intelligent machine, or I want to understand if some alien structure that I met is really intelligent, or if SETI has found a real intelligent system. So I don't have nothing in terms of modeling. No? And of course, we have an obvious purpose of building these intelligent machines that we are. For which we have a strong need. Right? So here we come to one of the important aspects of the approach to the study of intelligence. So how should I study life in biological system or intelligence in our natural system? Should I just analyze? So should I, or maybe I could, since I have a technological capability to do it, build a simplified model of that. Because if you think to the dog, no, we have seen the dog's Turing test a while ago. So this dog's Turing test, which looked successful to a certain extent, is actually performed by a dog. So, but the dog is actually the result of a lot of contingency, of a lot of history. So if I look at the genome or the brain structure of a dog, I will find a lot of information that is probably not really necessary. So it could be extremely useful. We will have some lectures later on this. It will be it's extremely useful to try to abstract what I think are the principles, and then to build a system which should exhibit, for instance, pass the dog or ants Turing test. So this is the idea behind the synthetic approach. So actually, at this point, engineering and artificial intelligence, cognitive science, becomes part of a game and part of a scientific method. So I build things to understand science because a dog is too much complicated for me to really understand, to remove the noise in the genes, for instance, from the real signal. So what is really needed to be intelligent? No? So it's the idea of understanding by building, and it is the idea of intelligent machines, robots, as a tool for scientific research, for basic scientific research. So this, just to, I move to the conclusion. So there is nothing, really nothing, in some sense there is nothing new in what we're doing now. What is new now is that we probably have the tools scientifically, conceptually, and technologically fit to do what was already envisioned before. Because this is a famous quote from Politics of already Aristotle, which more or less said that if every tool could govern itself by itself, we would not need apprentices or slaves. So, or people doing dumb and dangerous work in modern times. What I really appreciate is that looking at the original text, actually Aristotle used words which are really already pointing to what we think we are missing now, which is, for instance, this is that in English is translated by, I hope you read it before, or even of its own accord. Actually, in the original, it was something like, or by seeing what to do in advance. So actually, and the real word, proastaitomenon, well, okay, this word, was perceiving before. So actually, it was very clear to Aristotle already that the system needs to be able to anticipate. No? And then synthetic methodology approach, something that now we feel extremely not to the point. No? So this is our famous. We have several more in the same period in Europe and in Asia. We have developed mechanical system, which were kind of mechanical state machines connected to a mechanical system. And this is still very close to what is usual of the robots, at least that you see developed as product, no? Because this is still the living paradigm. No? So, I mean, the Japanese in 1796 already had the handbook of robotics. No? This is an important predecessor of Sicilianos and Catips. Right? And then there was some nice, this, unfortunately, I'm running short of time and I cannot do my usual comments on this, which is that actually, this Van Kempel chess player was a very popular robot system. What was a mechanical Turk which was able to play chess and to win. What happened is that after a great success in all the courts in Europe, it was finally discovered that there was a man in the machine, not a ghost, a man in the machine deciding the moves, right? And the paradox today is that today we could put a computer program inside. Where we fail is, as I told before, in this kind of tasks, or in being able to simulate also working. So robots don't work this way, which is a kind of control for robots. Or also this way. When I do this, I actually, in some sense, I'm controlling the fold of the arm, and only at the end I do some correction. I don't take any measure. So this is conceptually very different from what the still mainstream paradigm in robot. We will see many examples. Also, I mean, these examples are already capturing the idea, which now we think is wrong. No? So the metaphor of a clock. A clock governing a mechanical system, or a microprocessor with a Pascal C++ program governing a mechanical system, which, if you think about, is a very general definition of a robot. So now I want to, I really go to the conclusion. No? So this is, I wanted to say that the only time that I measured it, it was because I was an engineer. I am an engineer, right? So this polemic is not personal. I would be in favor of using IQ measured when you are 25, as not later, because maybe it could go down. And but what's the point? Because if it were a real measure of intelligence, there should be a very high correlation between professional, artistic, political success and IQ, right? And we don't see it. So, because if you think to this Mensa club, which only accept people which are in the top 2% of the IQ tests, which means around 140, which I would say most engineers have, and they should all be successful. So there we should be a one-to-one relationship with Mensa members and top politicians, top scientists, top research. It's not, right? So this means that we don't have this measure. So maybe the Turing test is much more appropriate. But who should perform the test, Turing test? And how many people should perform the Turing test to say that it is successful? And then just to finish, so another homework, think about this. So why, so I gave you many hints, but why is this IQ test not so productive? So should we invent something more, maybe a multivariable, multidimensional test would be better? So think about that. And then another couple of videos which really should explain what we are really looking for and what we think, at least at conceptual and paradigmatic way, we may have some answer for coping. Maybe we can see the two movies.
Okay,
this is a famous video which you can easily find in YouTube. No? What is surprising? So what we don't like? So this was 6 years ago. So I really think Asimov is one of the best example of engineering that we have today. No? But what is really surprising in this scene? It's surprising the way the system falls. So it's completely natural and also very dangerous for the system. So we fall in a completely different way. I don't say cats are also more intelligent at falling than we are. But it's clear that we do something that a robot is not programmed to do and is not able to do. And now we have another one. So this is the clock, what you may dub as the clock paradigm. So deterministic state machine managing a mechanical system. And this is a kind of peak of this kind of approach. And now let's see another movie. This is a realistic movie developed by Harvard University to teach biology to students. And so it's scientifically grounded. So this is a very impressive visualization of real scientific knowledge to current state. you are as amazed as I am by this video. But the short comment that I want you to do this is the following. So if you look at the first system was a very sophisticated, very elaborated, very complex state machine, forgive me for this simplification, governing a mechanical system. This is a massively multi-agent, stochastic, self-organized, self-orchestrating control system. So it seems completely another thing, embodied, because it's typical, for example, of proteins that they carry information, but they also have morphological and chemical and mechanical function. So multifunctionality, which is something that we don't put currently in our machine. So the point is that we are creating presence, the natural, and this is just the low level. This was the reaction, an immune reaction. So it was the reaction of a white blood cell to an antigen. So it's clear that the paradigms are completely different. We are actually talking about the second paradigm. So we are actually trying to analyze and put into at work a view of intelligence which is closer to the second one. I think that the good news might be a mirage, and you will kid me for years for that. But I think that we are not so far from really understanding this kind of processes and to synthesize them. So let's say that another homework for next time, think that it's homework in the sense of that you have to think about is to think about this, what is really different between anticipated. So, but think about the implication that this really have on the design, because a very simplified comment that I could do is that it's clear that our technology is on the azimuth side, not on the biological, natural biological system side. So far, to a certain extent, we will also have a few lectures on bio-inspired technology, and some nice lecture, for instance, by Luigi on synthetic biology. So, and let me, so I think that the carry-on message for today is that, okay, intelligence is not such an easy concept to grasp. For sure, we still have a lot to learn from nature, and probably we should go towards concept of embodiment, so giving a real assessment of what embodiment implies and what how to self-organize and orchestrating control, which is a challenging objective, but I'm an optimist by nature. I think in the next decade maybe, or decades, we may probably see. And that's all. I finish saying that the next lecture will be focused on embodied intelligence, and we will have not in flesh and bones, but in video, interactive video Rolf also, and the topic will be exactly this, embodied intelligence. In the meantime, I would suggest to start to have a look at the table of contents and the first couple of chapter of a text lecture textbook, how the body shapes the way we think. And we will probably post some additional reading material. As a last remark, we have a huge repository of guest lecture recorded on the ShanghAI Lecture website, where I think you may have also a very wide variation of the flavors that you can have on this kind of concepts that we share, and many people already share. And that's all. Thank you again for your attention, and see you next Thursday. Thank you.